And welcome back to Let's Play Torment, Tides of Numenera, Blind. I'm the RPG chick. We are in the bloom in Memovira's courtyard. There's slaves, there's people kicking Qianna as a refugee. We just talked to Dracogen last episode. These shanties are constructed entirely of tanned bloom flesh with a framework of harvested bone and gristle. We looked at most of this stuff. Saw this. This. This thing. Anyway. We gotta level up. Here's the map so far. Qianna is pretty important. She has her own little thing. Oh, we can rest there. I guess if we stop people from kicking the crap out of her, we can go rest there. Because I wouldn't want to rest there as it is now and have them kick us as well. Well, we can level up.
Forward
to the next level. The only thing we have is effort. Max effort. Intellect. Oh, max effort? Oh, never mind. I'm thinking of Edge, which we did last time. So max effort, yes. We have concentration increase, plus one training level. Nanos gain a free level in the concentration skill. And event horizon. Become invisible. Completely untargetable. Only removed when it expires. Not due to any action. Active for 3 rounds. One of one uses per crisis remaining. Reality bends to your will, hiding you and your actions from your enemies. So I guess this is an improved, like, sneak or hide or whatever they call it. Okay. Ooh, abilities. Two abilities. Resourceful. Not gonna read all this. We've been through at least some of these before. Additional ciphers, eh. Don't use them that often. We have other people we can give them to. Energize. Plague spirits? Ooh. I don't remember seeing these. Infuse critical hits with entropic forces conferring disrupted. Which should be a mouse over thing, should tell us what that means. On top of the normal effects of the ability. Entropic forces destabilize the target, causing negative effects to increase each round. When you strike true, your enemies quail. The damage you do lasts beyond the moment, devouring your foe's energies from the inside. How often do we get critical hits? Not very often, do we? Maelstrom.
Ooh.
Deals two of energy, chemical, mental, transdimensional, and relativistic physical as well, for a total of 12 damage. Even if you miss, you deal 1 damage per level of effort applied. Alright. Defended by willpower. You unleash a many-faceted assault upon all enemies before you, using every secret in your extensive repertoire. Pretty neat. All in a small area. Medium range. I like Maelstrom. Let's see what else we have. Quantum Step. Teleport one ally to a point within range. Entropic field. You create an energy siphoning vortex, weakening all within its radius. None can stand before you. On hit, confers vulnerable, which is minus 2 armor and minus 1 resistance. Armor reduction, minus 2 per tier. Resistance reduction, minus 1 point per tier. Active for 3 rounds. It could be useful. Incite action. Target an ally with enemies in weapon range, then choose one of those enemies. The chosen ally makes an immediate attack on that enemy. Interesting. Pretty good tactical option. Animate Balefire. Ooh. Ooh, I think I want this thing. Summons a construct that draws the attacks of all nearby enemies and fights on your side. The character can only summon one animate Balefire at a time. Active entire crisis. You call upon hidden forces for aid. They shape a mindless minion from your desire and bind it to your will. Awesome. Okay, I definitely want the Balefire, and I think so far the Maelstrom. Data Sphere Link. Okay, plus one training level in Lore Machinery, Lore Mystical, Lore Natural. Unstoppable Force. Gain plus two damage on esoteric attacks. Your unrivaled mental prowess strengthens your esoterics beyond the capabilities of weaker beings. It's only plus two damage, you know. Would be better if it was like a certain percentage per level or effort used or something like that. Gravity Manipulation. Space Warping Pulse that pushes or pulls all creatures in range. Right. Callistes has that. Mind Control. On hit confers control. Forces the target to fight on your side. Ooh, I like that. Two of two uses per day. Defend by willpower, of course. You seize control of a rival's nervous system and make her dance to your need. You spill discord among your foes, turning their strengths to horrible weaknesses. Wow. I really wish I could take the Balefire, the Mind Control, and the Maelstrom. But let me just take Animate Balefire and Mind Control. Boop! Callistes. Let's increase the stat pool. Like Might, because you have hardly any of it. Well, we can't. Okay. I guess we can never increase our Might. Because it's pretty low. I don't think we've ever increased it. Let's do that. One to speed, one to intellect. Okay, that's all we get for her. Tyvir. Let's increase... let's do extra effort. And Eretus. Yeah, see? We can increase her might, and we can increase his intellect. 10 and 10 for might and speed. He's yelling something, but it's so low that you can't hear. Okay, let's see if Dracogen has anything else to say here. We're really warned against him, dealing with him at all. Dracogen's flat eyes rove quickly across you, measuring and studying in a glance. He smiles warmly, but his eyes remain hard. You return, and more quickly than I had anticipated. Do you have something for me, perhaps? Or perhaps I can do something for you. Oh yeah. Help Eretus. One of my companions is infested with demons of some kind. Can anyone in this place help him?
I'll remember that.
Demons? It is not a question. He stares at you for a moment. No, I know nothing about demons. Perhaps one of the doctors in Chirurgeon's Slump will be able to assist you. Okay. I have questions for you. If they are within my power to answer, and if they do not come with a price. Ask away, my friend. Huh. Well, I guess when we return, when we meet people, we can come back and ask about people here. I'd like to talk about some of the people of the Bloom. I do not frequently indulge in gossip, but I see no harm in answering your questions. I'd like to talk about the Memovira. My old compatriot? I have told you what I wish to tell you. She is a hard woman in a hard position. She rose to her rank in the time-honored tradition of the Bloom with bloody knife in hand. She rules in much the same way. Having seen some of the more legitimate governments of the world, her way simply seems more honest. And he thinks, unfortunately, the traditions of the Bloom are not finished with her yet. Hard woman in a hard position. That's all I care to say now. What about this area? Why do you remain here, in particular? I remain here because a great number of things and people emerge from this particular entrance into the Bloom. I am equipped to deal with them, my friend, and to help with their needs, for I have traveled far and know much of the world. If they prove hostile, his smile turns dangerous, I am equipped for that too. Perhaps you will see what I mean someday. A great number of things and people emerge from this particular entrance, and I am equipped to deal with them like few others. What can you tell me about the other people in this chamber? His voice lowers conspiratorially. You've heard none of this from me, of course. Let me summarize. Near the well, you find Skady, a small-time merchant. She seems different of late, though why I cannot say. In the fighting ring near her, you will see an aeons-old killing construct. Waits for prey. Avoid it unless you wish to die. His gaze shifts. Near the great door to the fortress, excuse me, you'll see Bruska, the Memovira's hand and fist. A particular friend of mine, though not particularly friendly to others. Just as she wants it. He gestures. Then there's the slaver Parson Flint, who claims to abide by the rules. Untrue, of course, if you have the shins. Of the others, my heart rests with Qianna. Is that the proper term? No. No, I empathize with her. She is here through no fault of her own, a victim of chance, a kind spirit, and likely a dead one soon. The construct they call waits for prey, who does exactly that. Inquisitive minds are the sharpest minds, he thinks, though perhaps the most dull to speak with. Tell me more about yourself. He spreads his hands apologetically. I have a great deal to say about the subject. Most of it is interesting only to me. What is it you wish to know? What do you do for a living? I'm an investor. What is my business? I see you ask with your eyes, and so I answer for you. I deal in strange and exotic Numenera. The Bloom is a crossroads, a fruitful place, and I see much of interest. My particular clientele demands items of an interesting nature, and they pay me well for it. Well enough that I can afford to pay my finders generously and remain solvent. I buy and sell choice Numenera and occasionally assist explorers when our interests collide. How long have you been here? Quite some time, as ordinary humans measure it. I have made the Bloom my base of operations for a good 100 years. I have learned to avoid the political squabbles of its residents, for the political turns personal all too quickly. Personal and bloody. He smiles slightly. The ghosts of the past are always with us. In the Bloom, more so. He looks away for a moment. Time changes us all. Justice comes on its own feet. It is best to let events take their own course, and to steer clear of entanglements one cannot control. A good 100 years, more or less, as the TLDR. So you haven't been in the Bloom your whole life? He looks faintly offended. By no means. I've traveled from the Clock of Kala to the Steadfast and seen the towering crystal sky fields. I have journeyed to the Forge of the Night Sky, dodging fire whites and spills of magma. I stood upon metal moons to look down upon the earth and saw signs of life in the stars nearby. I have traversed time and space, bending light around the Nebula Bell, and seen myself transmuted briefly into pure thought. The Bloom is but a small stop. Speak of something else. What are you doing here? I am looking for useful and interesting Numenera, my friend. The Bloom is a crossroads of worlds, a place of power and pain, and a great many people from a great many places pass through here every day. I fund explorers, merchants, and other travelers who wish to bring back more for the collection, and I pay well. As I said, I'm a businessman, collecting items for my specific clientele. They pay me well for powerful Numenera, and so I make it my mission to find devices that might be interesting additions to their collections. That is all. Who are your clients? Tiber groans. Do you want to die, friend? You don't ask Dracogen prying questions. Dracogen shakes his head, the smile gone from his face. They are private individuals with no desire for their identities to be made public. They are collectors. That is all I will tell you. That is all I dare tell you. Hmm. You mentioned knowing about Mielavast before. What else do you know about castoffs and the Changing God? You asked to plunder a great deal of knowledge, but I suppose you'll discover these things sooner rather than later, and it would behoove me to have you think well of me. Again, the shark-like smile, but we should make your questions come one at a time. Okay, what do you know about Mielavast? Alas, I have only heard stories. I know it was a place of refuge, a sanctuary. I once sought it out. Its name means Stone of Wonders in an ancient, largely forgotten tongue, and I thought perhaps to acquire the stone. He smiles ruefully. I did not find it, naturally, but the search allowed me to make the acquaintance of a number of your brethren. This proved fruitful on several occasions. He thinks, to plunder the treasures of that place. Sadly, it will probably never be. What can you tell me about the other castoffs? I have had the pleasure of knowing quite a few. Some were excellent business partners and sources of information. Met Qianna especially, for she knew the Bloom and the city above. Inifir hid from his acolytes in the Bloom, but found no peace here. I have met with the Chalcedon and Paj Rekin as they sought advantage for their armies. Your kind are drawn here frequently, though they rarely stay long. He thinks, Mazov was an intriguing one. He did so much more than merely find treasures. A shame what became of him. Too many to recall, really. Your kind are quite prolific. What can you tell me of the Changing God? His mood darkens. Your sire is brilliant, but he is dishonest and untrustworthy. I dealt with him while he was in the body of one of your ill-fated brethren. He carried the amulet then, and he found that I should have it for my troubles when he had no further need of it. Instead, he locked it away in the Ascension, beyond my reach, and then he vanished. I would have taken my vengeance, but I discovered that the body that returned to me was not the mind that had left. It was through this interaction that I came to know more about your kind. But the fact remains that the Changing God is a scoundrel and a cheat, a man who breaks his word as easily as breathing. I first met him in the body of one of your older brothers. He cheated me out of the amulet, and I have never forgotten. I called it an amulet before, it's amulet. Tell me about the job you want me to do again. I was under the impression that you kept a journal to remind you of such things. But very well, I need you to acquire the magmatic amulet from the Ascension. I don't care how you do it or with whom you contract, but it is an item I greatly desire. Okay, farewell. Until next time, friend. He's got a little R2-D2 over there with him. Okay, so let's talk to this refugee really quickly.
We shall see.
We shall see the refugee. It's safe here, right? Safe, away from the gangs, away from the maws. So scared. Okay, let's help her. Why are you kicking her like that? A woman, barefoot and in rags, stands defensively beside her tent. Despite her obvious poverty, she crosses her arms and holds her chin high. And what do you want? She thinks, another dangerous-looking one. Gods, is there no end to the predators in this place? Well, the people who ran off? I guess they were supposed to have ran off. They're still kicking her. She points her chin in the direction of the tunnel that leads out of the courtyard. They are called Delny and Vrung. They've been squeezing money out of me for months. Protection, they call it. Though obviously they only mean from them. I wish I could do more than simply cave to their demands, but as you can see, I'm not exactly equipped to defend myself. It's all I can do to survive. How often do they steal from you? Too often. I barely have enough to feed myself, and then they take what's left. Usually more than what's left. Why not call the guards? I guess there are no guards. Guards? You mean the Memovira's thugs? All they do is guard her interests and extort memory from money from the gangs. They don't keep order, unless you can pay them. That's the way of the bloom. Downey and Vrung can do as they like, as far as anyone else is concerned. Maybe I can help. Where did they go?
Making a note.
They crawl out of a hole somewhere deeper in the bloom. Little Nihilish. Nihilish, I think it's called. I'm not the sort to wish violence upon anyone, even people like them, but I hope something happens to stop them. She thinks, I'm so naive, hoping for help. Still no harm in pointing one potential thug to another. Hey, I'm not a thug, potential or otherwise. Look at her closely. You notice immediately that her rags are actually made of high-quality fabric. It appears that they were once a fine green dress or gown, though it is now filthy and torn. She catches you looking and straightens her posture, seeming almost regal for the moment. Little Nihilish, but I've never gone there. It's a slum full of mutants, and the residents don't like normal humans. I'm afraid that's all I know. Tell me about yourself. She gives a weak smile and curtsy. My name is Qianna, the Bloom's most pitiable storyteller and self-styled innkeeper. Though I admit that inn is far too fine a word for my little tent. Still, I can provide a meal, a bedroll, and at least a modicum of entertainment in the form of tales from my homeland. Before I came here, I was a noblewoman, believe it or not, a courtier from Sturthal. She gets a faraway look in her eyes. It feels like a previous life. I wonder if I'll ever find my way back. She shakes her head. I suspect not. She thinks, even if I could leave the bloom and learn the direction of the steadfast, the journey itself would be lethal. I'm a teller of distant tales, keeper of this little tent where you may rest your head, and formerly a noble lady of Sturthal, but alas, no more. How did you get here? You've seen the katana, I assume. She gestures broadly at the massive broken vehicle behind her, being slowly subsumed by bloom flesh. No, I didn't see that. It's a kind of magical carriage, capable of traveling great distances by skipping over the space in between. Governor Marizek's priest determined that it came through Sturthal on a very precise schedule. It would appear at one of a few locations near Sturthal every 73 hours. Well, among the nobles, it became a sort of adventure. We would dare one another to board the katana, or even hold parties at a location where it was scheduled to appear. It was exciting. I knew people who went on such journeys and came back with the most wonderful tales. They'd spent a couple of days meeting strange, fascinating people, and visiting wild locales. Some, I am fairly certain, were not even in the Ninth World. I had to see for myself. She thinks Isaac always had the most romantic tales. Clouds of crystal. Piccolo's shimmering fields, a dome of water in the desert. So, about a year ago, my friends and I threw a katana gala in anticipation of its arrival. We packed and dressed for adventure, and when the carriage arrived, we boarded immediately. She clasps her hands in front of her and sighs. Sadly, that was the katana's final journey. It crashed here, tunneling through part of the bloom. Most of the passengers were killed in the crash, and the rest in the month since. I am all that's left of that voyage. She thinks, I only wished for a tale half as romantic as his were. Sadly, that will never be. You're a very strong person to have survived for so long. Indigo and Silvertide. I never considered myself strong. If I was truly strong, I might have kept the others alive, too. But thank you. It was supposed to be a brief adventure, but has turned into something else entirely. I am all that's left of our little expedition. Where's Sturthal? Hundreds of kilometers from here, from what I've learned. As I understand it, the bloom is located in what we in Sturthal call the Beyond, or actually, beyond the Beyond, as I had never heard of the Sagus Protectorate or any of the places people talk about here. Sturthal is one of the largest cities in the Steadfast. It perches on the edge of an enormous rift in the ground called Voile Chasm. Some streets and buildings even protrude from the cliff sides, not unlike your Sagus Cliffs, as I understand it. It's a cultural jewel in an otherwise war-torn nation. It's civilization, not like the beyond, or even this place beyond the beyond, though perhaps Sega's Cliffs might be comparable. And I come from one of the Steadfast's largest cities, Sturthal in the nation of Malevik, perched on the infamous Voyal Chasm. Hmm. I like to sleep here. Hmm. Of course, that will be 65 shins each. That's a lot of frickin' money. That's 260. Good God. Should I lie? Gonna mess up our gold tide here. I don't have enough money. Can I sleep here for free? She looks at you sympathetically. We are both refugees, are we not? Trapped inside this godsforsaken thing? I can let you stay for free once, but no more. She directs you towards her empty tent. I'll bring you a meal shortly. It's not much, but it's food. May you sleep well tonight. Oh, so sweet. Yeah, we're really,
I can breathe again.
You can breathe again? That's a good thing.
I feel better.
Yay. So yeah, we were really messed up by our... Not only first we went through that mirror, in which I used some abilities, and then I think we might have used something against the Spectre, who we found out was the Changing God. I think once or twice we used abilities, possibly. Or effort, rather. And then definitely in fighting and, well, getting hit by things and running away from the Sorrow's, fragments. When, the Massacre of Mila Vast, we lost a lot of hit points and used a lot of effort in moving things, rocks and things. So anyway. She has all these stories, and I don't think they're supposed to still be kicking her. Qianna raises her head in a businesslike manner, belied only by her surroundings. You've returned. I don't suppose you've learned anything new about Delny and Vrung? Okay. Farewell, madame. Well, let's go this way then.
Something to do.
Yeah, we're going to be talking to more people, that's all. These tents look and smell like nests of vermin. They're littered with moldy blankets and scraps of rotting food. What are you doing, sir? The bloom gives, the bloom takes, the bloom feeds. It feeds me and it feeds on me, but the container's warm to the touch. This massive vehicle, oh, that's what she was talking about, appears to have crashed through the nearby wall. Bloom flesh has resealed the hole and is beginning to grow across the vehicle's surface. You recognize the vehicle as a Qianna, a hyperdimensional transport from a prior world. Hmm. What about this refugee? As long as those thieves keep after Qianna, they're not coming after me. Nice. So we can interact over here. Do we dare?
I'm going.
A panel has fallen away from the side of the crashed Qianna, exposing a compartment that is filled with machinery. Waves of energy radiate from it like heat haze. I'm surprised we didn't get, like, red tide and stuff like that. Because I lied, right? Examine the compartment. Most of the machinery in the compartment is smashed and unrecognizable, hanging by wires and strips of torn synth. In the open spaces between the machines, tiny vortices of light and energy occasionally spring into being, obliterate everything they happen to touch, and then vanish again. Alrighty then. You recognize the vortices as minuscule singularities in space-time. Their presence suggests that this Qianna is powered by a transdimensional power source, which might be accessible from its aft section. As your eyes grow accustomed to the weird blurry haze, you notice a synth canister near the back of the compartment. It appears to be intact. If you stretch out your arm, you might be able to reach it. But if a vortex opens at the wrong time, you could be seriously hurt. Toward the back of the compartment you see an intact synth canister. Peer more carefully at the canister. If the interior of the katana is anything like a mechanical engine, you'd guess that the canister is some kind of coolant. Though given the size of the katana's engine, it's probably much more powerful than anything you've seen before. You suspect that the canister could be repurposed as a single-use device that could freeze anything or anyone in a matter of seconds. Let's use our quick fingers to try to remove the canister. I guess this is speed we're using. Success! You reach into the compartment, fingers scrambling at the smooth synth of the canister, trying to work it loose. A tiny vortex flares to life near your arm, but you snatch it away, and the vortex misses you by a few centimeters. Nice. With a final twist, you pull the canister free. Hypercoolant spray. The canister is icy cold to the touch. On one end, you find a release valve. If you open it all the way, the coolant could be sprayed out, freezing anything it touches. Nice. Target one enemy. Range is immediate. Okay, I guess you have to be right there in melee range, I'm guessing. Deals 25 chemical damage and confers stunned. Character cannot move or take actions. It's just active for 3 rounds. I guess you'd be stunned for 3 rounds. You recover this small canister from the crashed katana. It is made of smooth synth and is icy cold to the touch. On one end of the device is a valve that can be opened to release the coolant in an icy blast, freezing anything it touches. This improvised use would only be effective once. Okay. Now, I just want to look at this thing. We got... I'm not going to use that this episode. Wow, really? Liquid death. Yeah, we can't do anything with this. We picked this up at the, what do you call it? Mila Vest during the destruction and mass murder of the outcast there. I was pretty happy, though. We managed to save... I think we saved all the named outcasts. Even though... what's his name? Was not present. I write down the names, yeah. Elkashai was not near the machine. But when we activated the machine, it said that all the remaining surviving castoffs were pulled in. All of them. Not all the ones just in a particular area. So we saved the ones near the device, the Ferritory, or Andronis, Sandhand, Rima, and Melmoth. And Elkashai was further out into the middle of the field getting attacked. He was pretty messed up. He only had like, I don't know, like 11, 13 points left or something like that. And also 3 unnamed castoffs. So it's pretty sweet. We saved a lot of them. I'm pretty happy with the way that turned out. Yes, I am.
I'm ready.
I suppose the katana's already been scavenged for anything valuable. Hasn't it?
Of course.
Hold on. Let me look again, then. Yeah, you don't see anything else of interest in the compartment. Okay, I thought that was a hint of something.
Absolutely.
It was absolutely a hint? Yeah, they have supposed to be a runoff, so that's a bug, I'm pretty sure. So next time we'll talk to Decanted over here. And some exiles and slaves and such. We got a whole bunch of people we can talk to. It's the Philethus. The Philethus. Kosh. Kosh is still here. Well, Kosh is here now. I thought I, like, destroyed him or something. Very weird. He was back in the what do you call it? I can't remember the name. The first major part of the city that you come to. Circus Minor. Just hanging out in Circus Minor, kind of near the steps that go up to, you know, the Government Square. I can't believe I'm remembering names of places. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time when we explore more.
All the wonders of creation at our fingertips, and yet we stand still.
Well, because we're signing off and saying goodbye to the audience. Stay tuned for next episode, guys. We look at explore more of Memovira's Courtyard. Endure, in enduring, cross-trial.